This is Vegas All Net Radio, the final frontier of free speech.
Views and opinions expressed on this program are those of the hosts and guests and do not necessarily reflect those of Vegas All Net Radio, its affiliates, or its parent company.
Knowledge is power, and this is Powerful Stuff. Wellness Education Cannabis Advocates of Nevada present the We Can 702 Nevada Cannabis News Hour with the We Can Radio Team. For the next 60 minutes, we'll take an in-depth look at the cannabis reform revolution sweeping the nation. Now, let's fire up the news hour. Here is the We Can Radio Team.
Welcome back, listeners. This is Jason Sturzman, and to my right, I have Perry Haichu, and we have a special guest today. We have Phoenix Orion, and we have Nicole Inari in the studio. Today, we're going to start with an interview, and then we'll have a little bit of a discussion of some recent cannabis news. So Phoenix, yes. Welcome. And give us a little background.
Thanks for having me.
Yes, sir. Thank you for giving us your time.
Yes. Hello, guys. Hello, everyone. My name is Phoenix Orion. I call myself an entertainer. I wear so many hats. I started off as a dancer, doing dance choreography for early groups like Salt and Pepper, Kid and Play, you know, in the early 80s, and then moved to the West Coast, got a record deal. Have a gold platinum couple of under my belt.
As long as I've known you, Phoenix, you've always had the mohawk going. Did you ever get that high top Kid and Play look going?
Oh my god! Always been the mohawk. Okay, I'm gonna say this: we started it. The name of my group was called the High Top Posse, and I was a barber. I used to cut their hair. I cut mm-hmm. their hair. Yeah, so we kind of like started that hairstyle. It was called it was a group out called Cameo. Larry Blackman, who his was like the highest, and we imitated mm-hmm. that. And the name of our group, IOU Dancers. Yeah, we all. There was standard. You had to have a flat top.
Did you ever get to do the Kid and Play dance with him?
Again, I started that. You can look this up on Google. The little jump over the leg thing is so funny. I just seen Jimmy Fallon and Will Smith doing the history of dance, and about 15 of those dances that they were doing, me and my dance group back in New York City, we actually created those steps for those early acts. And then, you know, like I said, moved to the West Coast, got a deal. When I moved to Vegas, I've been here now 10 years. So I've been looking forward to the legalization, stuff like that. I've been part of the Million Man Marijuana March. Our guy, Dr. Weed, I always mm-hmm. thought that he was very brave. mm-hmm. Pardon me. Very brave in the very beginning for having the billboards. I applauded him. But I watched how the so-called first dispensaries was popping up and how the feds...
Are you talking about in 2007-8?
Yeah, remember when the feds came mm-hmm. in and they just basically took all the info. See, now that was a red light for me.
This was one of those shops, actually, Sin City Co-op was one of those shops that ended up getting raided.
Is it the one? Because I lived off of Silverado Ranch. It was over close over in, not that far in Henderson. Yeah, they came and they just raided the spot, and the only thing they took was all the patient's info. Mm-hmm.
You know? Yeah, that was a very unfortunate time in Nevada and Las Vegas is history, and I always continue to remind people who are new to the medical marijuana scene or new to the marijuana scene of advocates, patients that have been here for I have personally been a patient for over 10 years now here in Nevada, and how things have changed and some of the history of cannabis here in Nevada. And there's been many ups and downs and many times where patients have been felt that the police have come into their home grow and they've been unfortunately prosecuted by being a medical marijuana patient, or also to the dispensaries at that time. They were trying their best just to help give patients access to medicine, because up to that point, patients did not have any dispensaries. So
felt as though they were trying to fulfill the legislative intent of a previously passed bill, but the local regulations were never put in place. So they were just trying to force the issue, I suppose. And it blew up in all of our faces. Unfortunately, a lot of good people ended up going to jail.
Yes.
And, you know, I mean, here we are now. I mean, how do I put this? I heard someone say it best once. They say, the pioneers get slaughtered and the settlers get the land.
Yes.
You know, so those were the pioneers, unfortunately. And now the new settlers that have come in are laying the land down and hopefully getting the crops ready for.
Well, we're still here. We're pioneers ourselves. We're still here. We're trailblazers. Like, I am a pioneer. I'm still here.
Absolutely.
You know.
And speaking of pioneering, tell us about some of the cannabis events that you've done in the past, and maybe what's upcoming, and maybe what your intention is with some of these events. And I just think cannabis-based events are just incredible for the cannabis community because they normalize cannabis. It's great for us to be able to hang out with other people who believe in cannabis as a medicine. And please tell us a little bit more about that.
Okay, coming from Los Angeles, you know, it was legal there, you know, before, of course, it was legal here. I would like to give a shout out first and foremost to Chang Weisenberg, who is the creator of The Smokeout, but we all know him for Rock the Bells. But he got with Be Real from Cypress Hill, and they were doing The Smokeout, and The Smokeout was amazing to me because I just didn't understand how we were able to do what we were doing before the legalization. But evidently, Mr. Dr. Green Thumb.
Now, Smokeout was an event that,
yes.
Is it still running in California right now?
Well, it's kind of on a hiatus, which is, it doesn't make sense to me now. It really should come back being that it is legal now. But, you know, like I said, Chang kind of dropped that, dropped that concert and just picked up the Rock the Bells. I guess it was easier to take around the country, things of that nature, because
was that the tour that had Tribe Called Quest? And,
yeah, he actually brought back the full Wu-Tang, yeah. Like all the groups, was the Rock the Bells festival, that was that festival. Mm-hmm. But since then, you know, we've been pushing, of course, for the legalization and taking hell of a chances and risk. So, let me just make a long story short, because this all began for me really this year. it was during the Champs, and you know the first
Champs of the summer or Champs in spring?
Champs in the summer.
Okay.
It was Champs in the summer. I had called a friend of mine from Los Angeles who I've done a couple of events with, Mean Green. Mm-hmm. I myself do over 10 conventions a year. I've been a brand ambassador for over 25 years for different companies and different brands. And I just started dealing with medicinal marijuana and brands of that, you know, of that sort. I've also DJed 4 years for the AGE, that's the Andrew Glass Blowing Expo, over that they have at the at the Alexis Park, and it was over.
Yeah, the AGE is actually going to be a little bit earlier this year than Champs, from what I hear.
Mm. They wanted to split it up. They didn't want it to go to run concurrent. Yeah,
a week earlier. Champs is.
Yeah, they felt that it was taking away from their attendees having them run concurrent like that, which I it doesn't make sense.
How do you feel about that?
To me, it doesn't make sense because Champs is big. The bigger, it's the bigger draw. I say keep it that way so that people don't have to extend their stay. Think about the attendees. They don't have to extend their stay or leave,
or
go
vendors.
Home, ship all their stuff home, and then come all the way back again. See, I'm on the other side of it too as well with the people selling their products.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what they complain about. And then coming to conventions and can't even get like the internet after they paid sometimes $10,000 to $100,000 for a booth. You know, so, but again,
yeah,
we're
you gotta
a growing
pay
community.
Additionally.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Growing community. So I reached out to a friend of mine. His name was Mean Green. And I said, Green, I want to try branding you. I want to try branding a person because I knew we were getting close to legalization. And me as Phoenix Orion, I mean, not that many people know me in the medicinal community. I'm known for more for my, for drum and bass back in the day, for bringing that also here to Las Vegas and just all EDM stuff. And, you know, underground conscious hip hop. So I reached out to him to be the face of it. And we did a thing, Mean Greens and Medicated Marijuana Party. We got a mansion here in town through a friend of mine, Tony S. And just planned this party. We planned it right around now, this time of the year. I called and reached out to him and we planned it. And by the time it got back to the people over at Champs and Herb Magazine, it was so weird how it happened, Shay and all the rest of those guys, shouts to everybody. They thought that it was the Champs' party. And Champs was like, no, we kind of thought that was you guys' party. And then they had to reach out to us and was like, oh, it's you guys' party. We want to officially sanction it, put our banner on. And it was great because then Champs got behind it, and it was huge. Actually, when I say it was huge, that's where I got the idea to do Project X, because that party was actually the Project X. It was out the door. We had to turn away 200 people. We shuttle bus people in. Helicopters came. Police came, you know. And I mean, I talked to them. It was nothing they can do. That, to me, was the first sign that, wow, we're kind of here. To me, that was the triumph of the whole entire night, when I walked outside and there was at least 10 police cars, and I talked to the officer, and he was calm. He said the music is not the problem at all. He said the problem is the marijuana smoke. He said your neighbors are calling me because this entire neighborhood is lit up. He asked me, he said, is everybody in there of the age? And I said, yes, sir. I said, because this is an after party for the convention, and to even be an attendee at the convention, you have to be 21 years and up. So he said, okay. He took my ID. He wrote it down. He said, do you mind if we do a walkthrough? I said, no, sir. They did a walkthrough, came in. I mean, it was insane. I'm going to tell you honestly, it was insane. It got crazier than I thought it was going to be. We had dab rooms. It was just paraphernalia. It was so crazy. And they just walked around. We shut the music down, and they just left. And I came back, and everybody was like, still statues. And I'm like, the party continues, and it continued to be great. I mean, a couple of entertainers came by. Who was it? A Rappin' Forte came on later and shot a whole entire music video there. And that's where I met my other half sitting right next to me. She was at the party, and it was great. And we had fun, and we did another one later on within a year. But that gave me the idea to do the parties that I do now, call Project X. I have a property over in Henderson. And what I kept hearing amongst the patients is, you know, okay, there's dispensaries and places opening, but, you know, where do we go? Like, where do we congregate? Like, so where is it
Phoenix,
safe?
When is the next party that you have planned?
I was doing the events every Sunday. I took a little hiatus just for the rest of the year. I'm doing a spiritual cleansing and doing a cleansing for the house.
So and ayahuasca?
Just
store.
Yes. Yeah.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Okay.
You know, yeah. Wow, right on the nose. Yeah. I got the emoji to prove it. Time for a vision quest. But anyway, you know, burning my sage and frankincense and myrrh, things of that nature. Just, you know, to bless everybody whom I met this year, all the people, you know, you guys, people from Nevada, Norm, Cannabis, Vegas Magazine, so many people. We did the awards this year. That was great. The People's Choice Awards, the Cannabis Choice Awards. That was a great event. It was over a couple of 300 people there at the house. And, you know, everyone kept coming back, and I continued to do it. And I'm looking forward to next year and doing more sanctioned events, like more events that's just, you know, on the grid, not off the grid.
How,
this
how,
was off the
how
grid.
Can a patient keep up with these events? How can they find out?
Oh, the meetup. Yeah, the medicinal marijuana meetups. Yeah, it's always in the meetup.
But there's no certain website they can go to, no email list that they can subscribe to.
Or they
to,
can so hit me up. I am Phoenix Orion on my Facebook, directly on my Facebook. I like to deal with directly with people whom I deal with. Like, I have a couple of thousand people in all of my networks, and some of them 100,000 people, and I know most of those people. I talk to everybody. If you DM me, if you instant message me, it's going to probably be me getting back in contact with you, not like the person next to the person next to the person.
How would you spell your Instagram
and
slash Facebook?
I am Phoenix Orion. I am Phoenix Orion. I am Phoenix Orion.
Now, Phoenix, have you been to a few of the dispensaries, and you too as well, Nicole? And do you have any favorites? Have you picked anything up?
Well, okay, no pun intended, Relief. You guys, it's at the top of the list. It reminds me of Oaksterdam. Like, it's, and you invited me.
Yeah, thanks
and,
so much.
And you're like my real close friend. So, of course, I'm going to get behind you guys, support you first. I'm going to support everybody, but, you know, you guys were the first ones to reach out. I also know he's a DJ here in town, Dre Day, with the Wellness Center.
Nevada Wellness.
Yeah, Nevada Wellness. Mm-hmm. They were the second ones to reach out.
Yep.
They actually, that's who I did my paperwork through. I'm waiting to get it back right now, to get my card so I can go forth, because they were at the last Hemp Fest festival that we did, and they were signing people up there. You know, they were active in the community. So anyone is active in a community. It's not like this one is against this one. We're not, this is not like the nightlife groups, Las Vegas, okay? We're not going to do like the nightlife groups do. None of us are in competition with each other. I mean, the Green Rush is huge. There's, if it's about money, there's money to make. With us, it's not about money. We are real activists. We can. Yes, we can.
And I think sometimes businesses, they, when we first opened Beauty Bar up downtown and more businesses opened up in that area, a few people said, oh, we have all this new competition, you know, that's steps away. And I believe that the more competition we have, more dispensaries we have, the more benefit that we're bringing to patients. But you're also bringing more benefit to all those dispensaries too as well, because the more of those individual dispensaries put more money into their marketing,
yes,
they're attracting more individuals. People are going to want to go from dispensary to dispensary, check out all their products. Some dispensaries have very different products than others. Mm-hmm. Some will have edibles. Some will. Some have concentrates. All of them eventually are going to have edibles, concentrates, all forms of flower. Hopefully we're going to see, I was talking to Bill from Vegas Cannabis Magazine yesterday, mm-hmm, just hanging out, and we were talking about how important it is for patients to get some RSO, to get some other mm-hmm alternative products on the shelves of these, capsules included,
yes,
suppositories, things that are very specific to the certain patients' needs, especially those with cancer, children that need these specialized oils, and also yeah, patients that need
CBD oils,
high CBD
yes
oils, high CBD type flower.
It's up to the patients, though, like we were talking last week. The patients have to let these dispensaries know that that's what they need. It can't just be a singular voice or like, hey, this or that. Like when you go in there, if they don't have it, just let it be known. If they get enough of those requests, they will let their production managers and cultivation managers know that they need to a lot.
That there's a certain demand for it.
Yeah, they need to allot a certain percentage of their cultivation facility for this product. So let's just hope that let's hope to reach out appropriately.
Mm-hmm.
Get that message through.
Yeah. So have you tried some of the products from either Las Vegas Relief or Nevada Wellness Center?
I've had some from some products from you guys.
Wow. Is there anything specific that really stood out?
Well, I love the really Kush.
Like? Okay.
Kush. I'm the Kush guy. Yeah, I mm-hmm like the Kush. You guys got some really exotic stuff.
What's your favorite?
And I like the display. OG.
OG. Okay.
Straight up OG.
OG Kush?
OG. Speaking of strands, can I do something really quick?
Sure.
Marijuana, Chiba Chiba, Reefer Madness, Cannabis Sativa, Sesamelia, Ganja Weed, Pastor Dutchie, Burn the Trees, Granddaddy, OG Kush, Purple Haze, Train Wreck for Days, White Widow, Afghani, Blue Dreams of That Mary Mary, Bubblegum, Chocolate Tie, Taste So Good You Can't Deny, Hash Sheeps, Hemp and Herbs, Maui Wowie, Hawaiian Herb, Sticky Icky, Super Skunk, Hydroponic, Cali Chronic, Lamb Spread, Wake and Bake to the Head, Keith's Dab Straight to the Head.
Nice.
That's one of the nice. That's one of the songs I like. I am a rapper, guys.
Yeah,
I do rap. I do
Teddy.
Do that too.
Not,
like I'm a rapper.
Anything, so.
I do rap, people.
Yeah, nice.
But like I said earlier too, like I actually off radio, we were talking about how we can spread the word and become more legal faster here in the States. I know, I rub elbows with Snoop, your Wiz Khalifa's, your Schoolboy Q, Afro Man, Be Real, and these other artists. And, you know, we want to make them become activists. You know, you guys have been living off the plant for a long time now. You know, like, give back. Like, the plant has been giving to you and giving you good times, you know. It's
absolutely
real simple. Like, you've been doing it when it was illegal. Now that it's, you know, it's legal, like, why don't you help us further push for the legalization so now you don't have to worry when you're riding on your tour bus or you're in a certain part of the United States or you're in your hotel room and you just want to unwind. You don't have to go and hide anymore mm-hmm or risk your entire career over someone saying, oh, such and such was caught with an ounce of weed. And, you know, Lil Wayne, I know he went through that. Drake has went through that. Even back in the days, Run DMC, those guys have, you know, they went through that. You know, this has been going on forever. This is a great time, you know, for users and for patients alike.
And just to segue away from what you're saying right there, Pittsburgh has decriminalized pot possession. So according to the 2013 National and American Civil Liberties Union report, African Americans in Pittsburgh are 5.7 times more likely to be arrested for marijuana possession than white residents. Mm-hmm. So their council there just recently, 7-2, in favor of a bill that you can now have up to 30 grams, which is close to an ounce, on your person, or 8 grams of hash, and it's only up to $100 fine. Before that, it'd be a misdemeanor, and it would affect your job. Mm-hmm. It potentially would affect maybe your school, your federal Pell grants too as well.
Oh, of course.
And we're seeing nationally that huge changes and just a change in thought of city councils, states, that have decided to make a turn for the positive, and have seen that medical marijuana is just beneficial to children, beneficial to people that are suffering from terminal illnesses, and also that if somebody even uses cannabis recreationally, they shouldn't have their life affected for the rest of their life just because they decided that they wanted to ingest cannabis or use cannabis as their medicine.
Because being arrested is very traumatizing, It's very traumatizing, and I mean, even once you get into, the system, and that's a whole other thing too as well, and that's on your record. No one wants to feel like I'm a criminal now. And I'll be honest, the first time that I even tried marijuana, I mean, of course, I got it illegally. I remember I was in my teens. I was a teenager. I was around 18 years old. And people did it, of course, around me. My parents have been hippies since the 60s. So, I mean, I did it on my own. I was like, okay, I'm going to try this. My own, I remember when I brought a sack. It was like a nickel bag. And I just, the way I felt, though, I felt like a criminal. I felt like a criminal. I went and hid to do it.
With your sheets and sticks?
Yeah, dude, it's so weird. I went and, I got my nephew, who's a year younger than me, went and I was like, look what I got. Like, you want to try this with me? We went and we just smoked it.
How'd you smoke it?
We rolled it up.
Yeah, I couldn't even roll it. I made a pipe out of tin foil because that's all. I was like, I'm gonna make a pipe out of tin foil.
Okay, see, when I said everyone was doing it around me, I was the designated roller in the house because I wasn't the smoker. Mm-hmm. So I used to roll for everybody in the house.
Roll cigarettes.
Okay. Like really, really nice. Uh-huh. And then so I knew how to roll, and we tried it and just giggled and laughed, and that's all we did. I was like, that's what this does. That's it. And got hungry afterwards. Okay, I like this. But I also think I also think that there are a lot of users out there who don't know that they're patients. Mm-hmm. Because you haven't been diagnosed.
I mean, that's 100% true, because I was going to say I grew up in Detroit, and there was a political party called the Party, PARTIE. And they were libertarian, very left, all for people's rights and everything else. And so it was in the early 90s, and we did a smoking protest on the University of Michigan campus. Mm-hmm. And it was so amazing because it was civil, everyone was smoking out and everyone was really cool, and everyone was pushing for for medical mostly. It's like, yeah, okay, recreational, whatever. But it was for medical and for textiles. For hemp, because as long as I knew about marijuana, I've always been very, very political and medical in how I did any of my extracurricular things, as it were. And we'll just leave it at that. And so I had learned more about the textiles and the good things that hemp and cannabis had did for the world before I even cared what it did to make me feel the way I felt. It was just illogical to me that it was illegal for so long, but of course you see the bureaucracy of how it kills the textile companies and the petroleum companies and the Lilly Pharmaceuticals and everything. Absolutely, all about it. And but to touch on what you're saying about self-medicating is that I used to tell people all the time, it's like, I smoke weed so you can deal with me because I am going to be bouncing off the walls, jumping trains, talking a million miles a minute, and you are not going to know what the hell just happened. So I need to smoke weed so I can be around you and you can deal with me. And they're like, wow, that's so interesting. I'm like, no, seriously, because if I'm totally sober, I can be too abstract to people who just are not on living on a higher vibration. And so it's just it's very calming to a lot of stress levels. But you know.
I tell people I get high to come down.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm the same way. I'm just kind of off the walls, hyperactive a little bit until I, you know, smoke and it really mellows me out. But I think that's an issue too as well. There are a lot of people who are patients and they don't know it. I also, you know,
well, because it helps with sleeping disorders and anxiety disorders and you know, things like that you know, people self-diagnose all the time and go steal their friend's Xanax or something.
Mm-hmm. You two were kind of talking. We were talking before the show a little bit. And you kind of touched on it very briefly. We all know about the obvious can of celebrities like Cheech and Chong and Willie Nelson and people like that. Why do you think that some of these other, what we would consider can of celebrities, in specifically the hip-hop community, haven't taken more of a proactive stance in the legalization movement? Do you feel like it's because they feel like they haven't been approached by the powers that be? Or maybe they just haven't seen it as a benefit to them, or you know, like, or
it's a combination of both.
Do you think that there is like room for them to be a part of that, or a desire? Do you feel like some of the, you know, these people may be patients in disguise?
They are.
And I think there's a four-point way to answer that one
with you, and it's a combination of both. Like, where is the organization that's approaching your Snoops, your Wiz Khalifas, your, and I don't want to put other people on blast, but these are the guys that publicly say.
I mean, Wiz, I mean, he's got his raw papers out there.
They're shying away from people like that mostly, I feel like. The National Cannabis Industry Association is one of the more prolific national lobbying organizations, I suppose, that's going to D.C. and trying to push the buttons on a congressional and senatorial level. And they fired Chong as one of their spokespeople because they felt like they're like, oh, well, you know, we don't want our suit and tie image mixing with his stoner image, as they see it, their old school stoner image. So they decided to distance themselves from him in a very, what I perceived as a disrespectful manner. Like, they could have said, oh, you know, Tommy, we're very grateful for the contributions you've made in bringing it to the forefront of the mindset of the American people over the past 40 years of your life. You've dedicated your whole life to the movement. You've gone to jail for this and this and that. And, you know, we thank you. But, you know, now we're passing the torch. We're going to allow you to pass the torch to this new generation. But they didn't do that. They're like, well, we're distancing ourselves from Tommy because he's a pothead. And it's just like, man, like, you know, I just didn't like the tone they took with him. So maybe something like that is why some of these hip-hop artists have stayed away, because they kind of saw, I don't want to say they saw Tommy get thrown under the bus, but, you know, that had to have been seen by some of their public relations people or something like that. So I don't know.
I'm going to give you an example. I was arrested on tour.
Okay.
For marijuana. And this was so, like, I mean, oh God, I just gotta be honest. It was profiling, which is just, oh,
which
boy.
State?
It was upstate New York. I was in Buffalo, New York City. I was on tour. This is like 1996. I was on tour. It was a hip hop rock band called Plastique. I had just got off the stage. I actually did not smoke. I literally just got off the stage. I was dripping wet with sweat. I was just trying to, you know, unwind. And a couple of the other band members they were in the bathroom as well. And with some people who were, you know, who were just out there, some fans, and they offered, you know, they had a bowl. They said, guys, you want to smoke? And
hell yeah.
I was, I'm gonna tell you honestly, I didn't. And I was on my, cause I was just like, can I get my breath? I need to get my breath first before I can inhale. So I was winding down and I went back to the, by the time I got back to the van to change my jacket, it was wet, my shirt, and I went back because I wanted to smoke. One of the guys in the band was already getting arrested, like, and a couple of friends who I brought with me on tour, and I'm like, well, what's going on? They're like, yo, they're arresting us for smoking. They said we have weed. And I talked to the officer. I was like, no, I don't have weed. And he grabbed my arm and turned me around and arrested me as well. And before I knew anything, I'm in jail. I'm off the tour bus. I'm in jail. I was just on stage, and I'm in jail for actually doing nothing. And it was weird because the guys who actually had the marijuana, they were, like I said, some of the fans. We had nothing. And luckily, we didn't have nothing. We didn't have anything on the bus. We didn't carry anything with us. But I'm, like, in jail, and I'm looking at my homies who was, they was, you know, the look on his face, I'll never forget. He was so sad because he was just like, wow, like, I read his face. He was just like, Phoenix, like, I just wanted to come on the road with you to just go, like, now I'm in jail. Like, how do I, like, I got a case now. We got to go to court. And, like, and one of them didn't even smoke. So I just felt right. so bad about that. And I never forgot that time. And, of course, I was on tours, I was on the road. I probably have a case still, an open case. The promoter was, he was so freaking embarrassed. He paid for us. He bailed us out. Like, we bailed, we had to get bailed out. I think it was like $1,700 or something to bail all of us out, because it was like three or four of us who they arrested just off the, off of the tour. And that's, you know, to answer your question, I bet there's a lot of artists out there, like I was seeing, like Lil Wayne's and these guys like T.I. and the rest of them, you know, who get picked up. We have this on our records now, like, and in America still, you know, people look at marijuana as a drug. Because there was a huge war on drugs, the war on drugs. And, you know, they piled us in with your Noriegas and these people who were moving like cocaine.
They classified it under the wrong classification in the first place, just part of propaganda. Just
and fear.
Bureaucracy.
Yes, back again. So us as this new generation, like us, our job, you know, we got to, you know, it's a fun job, I mean, but...
we still have
some awareness to do.
So you think there's a little bit of bitterness and possibly
not bitterness, just reluctance. They're just reluctant to, they're like, what do I get out of this? What am I going to get out of this now? Am I going to get this erased from my record? Well, you know, feel me? Like, if we can give some type of incentive. I know that there will be artists like your Cali Buds and maybe people who will step up and still, especially Be Real, be like, hell yeah, I'm with you, Phoenix. Start a movement. The Groovement, which is our green movement. You see, we had to start a campaign, give them a build it and they will come, basically. You know, build it and they will come. Like we were talking earlier, too, about the Smoke to Vote you had mentioned to me, like something.
Yeah, normal Smoke to Vote.
Yeah, something like that, like get them involved. And we have to approach them. Again, I say we, but I'm really me.
Well, they always say that young people don't show up enough to vote. They always push those numbers every 2 years when they have the congressional or the presidential elections. They always come back after and they say, oh, look, the young people didn't show up to vote again. And how are we going to get young people
because
to vote?
Because they're not trying to bring the young people in, because they're not bringing. I mean, did Bill Clinton do it last?
Yeah,
and I mean, then, Obama kind of did, you know.
But
it's about bringing it, making it relevant to
these
hip
hop artists. Have so much draw, so much social media influence, so
and
much
they are
potential.
Also young people, and they are not taught how to respect what we can do to change our future.
You were saying, oh, you know, all these people have been arrested, and it just kind of hit me. Do you think there are any of them that haven't caught a case at this point just because of the nature of the industry and the overly aggressive tactics by law enforcement? I bet
smoking
there probably
gun,
isn't much of them that haven't caught one, myself included.
It's called smokinggun.com. On smokinggun.com, I'm on there. 50 Cent is on there. Lil Kim is on there. Nicki Minaj is on there. Jay-Z is on there. And on smokinggun.com is all Elvis Presley is on there. Johnny Cash is on there. It's every entertainer's criminal records publicly for people to see. And you can just see how possession of marijuana. I think even maybe Sammy Davis is on there. Like, it's so many. You'd be astonished of the people who you see who have these cases for possession. Because it's like, I'm an entertainer. This is what I do. And if you just run up on my tour bus or my room or catch me for doing something, I'm more than likely 9 times out of 10, I'm going to have this with me.
And
speaking of websites, to kind of move into, have you guys seen stonersloth.com, an Australia media campaign saying if you use marijuana, you're going to turn into a sloth? They have various videos. I showed Perry it earlier today. I just think they're completely hilarious.
They're very well produced, actually, which is the best part. They obviously put a lot of money into the campaign.
Again, propaganda, like Reefer Madness type of propaganda.
But they're finding that this thing has actually come back and hit them in the head, because 95% of the people that are sharing it are other cannabis consumers, and they're just making fun of it because
absolutely
saying that it's just if you get a chance, stonersloth.com.au. Yeah, go laugh at it.
And with that, we're going to have to take our first break. We've been so wrapped up in the conversation, we almost forgot. So we'll be back in a couple of minutes, and thank you for staying with us.
You're listening to the Weekend 702 Nevada Cannabis News Hour. Now, here again, the Weekend Radio Team.
Welcome back, and thank you all for joining us. We're here with Phoenix O'Ryan and his lovely better half, Nicole.
Ivy.
Buddy Jason Sturtzman, and we're just going to jump into a couple of news stories before we kind of get back to what we were previously discussing, because we still got a lot of stuff to cover. So, this story is from the Phoenix New Times, which I guess for our local listeners would be the equivalent of our Las Vegas Weekly, I've been told. Mm-hmm. And there's a story here about how the legalization movement has sparked no significant increase in teen marijuana use, regardless of what a lot of prohibitionists say. People like Kevin Sebbett of the anti-marijuana movement. I forgot. I think the Smart Approach to Marijuana, or Project Sam, is what he's a part of. They're a big anti-marijuana lobby that's really been kind of trying to poke holes in the legalization movement and try to slow our progress down. Has been pumping these states full of rhetoric that if you legalize medical or recreational marijuana, that the teen use is going to really spike. And that's just not really, that's not really the case. There's a lot of studies that this paper has tracked down that have said that the numbers have actually gone down among teens or remain relatively stable in most of these jurisdictions. And they point to Arizona, where there was a drop and things like that. And of course, these companies are trying to pick the markets where the legalization argument is being held to spread their message, and the anti-marijuana advocates are doing the same thing. So I'm just happy that someone is out there kind of beating that drum for us.
And also too, there's studies showing that dropouts of and high school dropping out is decreasing.
Yeah, they got the graph right here.
The graph's right there. It's also as well, I think, I hope that once we get to Initiative Petition 1, 2016, once that gets closer, that we're not going to see a opposition that uses lies, disinformation, like they did in Florida, to sway it away from recreation.
Well, you see, now you just opened a whole nother argument. We don't even have the article in front of me, but I know you're aware, and maybe some of our viewers and listeners are aware, that Sheldon Adelson, he's the owner of the Las Vegas Sands Corporation and the Venetian Palazzo Hotel here, mm-hmm. has recently purchased the Las Vegas Review Journal, which is basically the largest and only significant newspaper publication in the city.
I've seen that on the news, yeah.
And the reason why that's significant to us in the marijuana industry is because he flexed his muscle rather significantly in the Florida election recently and did a very good job of disinforming the voters to the extent that the bill did not pass. Usually he's not so successful.
It was a petition
very similar to ours. That's very, yeah, this mm-hmm. is true. I misspoke.
I was amazed that was the turnout too. That was ridiculous.
Well, like they won, but mm-hmm. they lost. They got more of a percentage
like
of the vote. 54%.
They needed 55.
It was 60. They got 57 and needed 60. Yeah. They got more of a percentage than the two states that actually voted to legalize it got mm-hmm. as a percentage basis. But because of the way it was written and the petition, it was a mess. But anyway, I am very concerned that he will use his power for what I perceive as the wrong, for evil, for the wrong reasons, mm-hmm. To utilize this newly found media authority by him and his family to spread his message that, pot is the devil, because, I believe he had a family member, possibly like a son, you were telling me, that was succumbed to an overdose.
Yeah, but it was heroin.
Well, still, we see people.
Oxycodone, like, actually.
I understand mm-hmm. that, but we see people like Carly Fiorina
on television talking about
this.
They pile us in. Marijuana is not a drug, and they pile us in with drug users.
Well, I saw Carly Fiorina on one of the Republican debates, like, stop the whole show and tell the story about how, she lost a son to a drug overdose and how we can't be sending, kids the wrong message about marijuana legalization and this and that. And I'm like, you can't have
two
this,
different subjects.
Yeah, you can't have one with the other. And it just really shows how uninformed these people who are running to lead our country are, or how they purposefully shove the science down below because they it doesn't fit their worldview.
Well, no, it's because they're using it. They're using it as a platform just to benefit their own monetary gain and power. It has nothing to do with what is right or what is wrong, or what is logical or beneficial.
I hope, I would like to think that they're just genuinely misinformed, because if it is about money, we're in big trouble.
That's how it's been.
Well, you know,
at the
end of the day, everything is about money.
Of course.
Especially when, you know, it comes to the powers that be. It generates to money. If they can't make money off it, then it's like we're against it.
It's not all about money, though, because there's so much money in cannabis. If it was all about money, you would see these entities looking to buy us out rather than crush us.
Well, because you're talking about.
I don't know. I've heard, and this is around the late 70s, 80s, that. The tobacco companies already started getting patents on the names of marijuana back then, like your Sesamelia, your Tide Stick, your Buddha.
Yeah.
Heard that.
So thing is, this is decades what ago. I said to myself. I seen them doing that. They see in the not-so-distant future.
It's R.J. Reynolds.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
yeah, in the Philip Morris.
Future, mm-hmm. them packaging it like cigarettes with filters and it being sold at your 7-Eleven and your Walgreens.
They're,
and that
trademarks with
they're
names.
Conveniently sitting on the sidelines. I don't think they're going to donate against it, but I don't think they're going to jump in on our side either.
No.
Because we've spent a lot of time demonizing the tobacco and alcohol industry throughout our.
Well, plus, think about you have the private businesses that own all the jails. Okay, that's being affected.
Like Corrections Corporation of America.
Yes. So you have the correctional facilities that are being. That are going to be damaged, yes. And then as far as their profits go. And then, the pharmaceutical company is extremely angry because you're curing cancer with a lot of the RSOs and such.
They don't want people growing medicine in their closet. This is true.
No, but aside from that, you're cutting it because pharmaceutical companies don't make cures. They create clients. That's all they do. And so with things such as hemp and cannabis and marijuana that can actually cure things, of course they're going to fight against it.
Big money.
Yes.
And when
very
you say big
so.
Money, think about it. Like she's like, it goes as far as this. Hospital beds won't be filled.
Yes.
Cemetery plots won't be
filled. It's a trickle-down effect.
I would like to see that.
Doctors won't be like needed.
I would like to see that as
pyramid.
A national policy. What if we had less people go to the hospital next year than we did this year? How about that as a national policy? You know,
I'm
they're
all
not
for
gonna,
it.
That would be wonderful.
You know, it's just you'd have to look at these proactive solutions, though. Like
no, I agree with you. Okay, I'm sorry, but I digress. Like but you were talking about the politicians, and so why wouldn't the politicians want to do this? Well, because they are funded. They are funded by big money, and so when anything that affects big money, they have to be careful because then they're going to lose their sponsors.
Yeah, a lot of them are funded by Pfizer, GlaxoSmithKline.
Mr. Adelson has all the money in the world. This is all about what's in his head. You know, his decision. It's not about his business at the Venetian or he's giving those millions of dollars to donate to open these rehab facilities because he feels like it had an impact on his life and he's going to do something about it, damn it. And he's got the power to, and he's going to squash these dopers. And that's what I really am afraid of. He's kind of slowly positioning himself to make a move on this. Well, I don't know if he's going to or isn't. We're hoping he stays out of it. The liquor distribution companies have kind of gotten their hand into the marijuana industry, the legalization lobby. So I'm hoping that
it's all a game of chess.
They dictate price and alcohol to the properties. I'm hoping that they kind of have the authority to say, look, you better back off because we have control over one of your products.
I mean, and the individuals that are involved in the cannabis industry in Nevada are very different than Colorado, and very different in some other states. I mean, you have lawyers, you have doctors, you have business owners, car dealership owners, you have people that have come from casino families.
Yeah, we would have casino owners if gaming control would have allowed it.
Yes, absolutely.
Is it true in Washington now? They can no DC our capital. You can no longer take a urine test to check for marijuana.
I think that's only if you work for the city or something like that. It had to do something like that. There was some kind of weird restriction.
I find that weird. Let's talk about this, guys. Like, why would you? So, what is that saying to us? He's a person to me. I'm not an idiot. That says to me, all you guys in Washington smoke weed, and first you want to protect your own ASSs first.
You know? Of course. I think that is exactly what it is.
They don't want to be tested for it. They're like, well, what about
Washington State or Washington, D.C.?
D.C.
The capital.
I think it has to do with, like, you know, the unions and, you know, I mean, there's a lot of moving parts behind the scenes that I'm not really aware of with that. But I definitely want to explore that more. I want people to be able to go to work if they smoke, especially medical cannabis.
Yes.
We've had to sacrifice that in order to get that bill passed, but really it's not what anybody wanted, and it really does kind of shove us down in that that stereotypical hole, like, you know, oh, well, you potheads don't have a job. It's like, you won't allow me to enter the workforce. How are you expecting me to do this if you won't allow me to take my legally prescribed, state constitutionally mandated medicine, yet you will... You know, you'll on one hand, you'll let me take it, and the other hand, you won't let me work. So what the hell am I supposed to do? And then you
oxymoron.
Yes. Kick us down, and it's just like,
that's exactly,
you know,
why I have stayed lots out of friends. It, and I didn't. I still haven't gotten my card yet, because especially in Nevada, because it was like, oh, for a minute it was kind of legal, but oh yeah, and then they killed all the co-ops and everything else too, and then the other thing that really bothered me is how it affected your right to bear arms and buy arms in Nevada.
It's not, they're not going to stop you from buying a pistol. They will. They're not going to stop you from buying a long gun. They'll probably stop you from buying a pistol. They will stop you from getting a concealed weapons permit. That's a fact. They took mine away from me.
Yes, that happened to a very good friend of mine, and then he realized he can buy person to person, but he just can't go to a shop and buy.
Oh, sure.
So it's pointless.
Be careful with that. Straw purchases are illegal. Also, if you knowingly buy a gun, Jason has a medical marijuana card and I don't. If I knowingly go into a store and buy the gun to give it to him because he has a medical marijuana card and I'm aware of that, and they can prove that I was aware of that and that was the reason.
I know, but
that's,
it's
called
pointless.
A straw purchase, and that's a felony.
Okay, no, I totally get it, but it's pointless.
Wrong. Oh, it's crazy
it
talk.
Is
it's pointless. Absolutely insane.
It's
totally, you know, the wrong. Fact that people who
it's
jump through just, all
it's
these
still
hoops
discrimination.
To register,
it's still discrimination.
Well, we register with the state.
You're a marijuana smoker now.
If we
I don't
register
want you to
with
have
the state
a,
and
a,
jump
a
through
the
hoops, we don't, we lose the right to protect ourselves because we jump through other hoops to get that same license. Okay,
stop.
So according to my wonderful producer here, in 2014, pre-employment drug testing stopped in Washington, D.C. completely. Not just for city workers, but total. For anyone doing business in the city.
Wow.
You see, I think in Las Vegas, the key to doing that would be a local initiative petition. Bob Beers and Stavros Anthony, local Republican councilmen, were very upset with the mayor's trying to forcefully push through the soccer stadium a few months ago. So they got together and they decided to join forces and register the voters and get the little
we
thing
can
going
reach
on.
Out, like you said,
and
a petition. Reach out
if
to the nightlife
groups.
If we
get a local initiative petition to do something similar, you could at least start the argument of forcing businesses that operate in Las Vegas to do that. But really, they claim it's all about insurance and this, that, and the other. So,
we can like to spearhead something like that?
We would love to do something like that. We just don't want to step on the wrong toes at the wrong time.
That's key.
Understandable.
We can't make the wrong, we got to choose the battles we think we can win. We want to fight all these battles, but really, you know, resources are limited. There's not enough hours in
a day.
So
that's when you need somebody like me.
Comes up
it's a game of chess.
We need to register people to vote.
I'm willing to be that guy.
We need to register people to vote,
and
we need to get people motivated.
They crucify me. I'll take that.
And I mean, speaking of what WeCan is doing kind of also behind the scenes and also with patients too as well, is Jen Solis, myself. Jen Solis is part of the Marijuana Council.
Mm-hmm.
She represents patient issues as part of WeCan. Also, I represent cultivation and production. The Marijuana Council is established by, headed by Senator Farley and also Senator Siegerblum.
Mm-hmm. Bipartisan leadership.
Yes, and this Marijuana Council, we've been having we had a cannabis event in December where we took patient input. We're bringing this input to Farley and Siegerblum. What we're doing with that is we're going to make changes in 453A. We're making changes in the Nevada code in the next when we have the next legislative body meeting in Nevada.
Mm-hmm.
So right now, personally, what I'm doing is I've been working with other medical marijuana establishment owners, and we are trying to make a case for increasing the amount of patients by making the card process easier. So it's taken about 2 to 3 months to get your initial application. Your renewals, it's a little bit quicker. You should never wait until the last minute. As soon as you get your renewal packet, take it the next week over to your doctor. But it's you still have an opportunity to purchase cannabis at your dispensary, because they can pull you up in the portal and see that you have not gone to the DMV yet, and that you've also sent your paperwork to the division. So those are some of the things that we're working on. As part of Weekend, we posted recently on our Facebook page. Please add us on Facebook if you are on Facebook, and tell us how long it took you to get your card, because we're sending that information to the state of Nevada to let them know that it's not acceptable that patients have to wait 3 months
once
for their
card. One of the strengths of being a Nevadan is our ease of access to our legislators. It's very easy to get a hold of these people. You can walk in the door and go talk to a lot of them, especially during legislative session. If we have enough voters that have an issue, they'll listen to you. So, like I said, we need our voices to be heard, and it starts with you. Mm-hmm. And do we have any events coming up that we need to mention or anything like that, since we're kind of running short here?
Nothing we have scheduled yet for Weekend. I mean, we always have on the second Saturday of the month, we always have our patients meeting
at the Coffee Bean and Tea Leaf.
Yes.
Did we across the street from UNLV.
The card game?
The card game?
Yeah.
What's that?
Someone talked
about that. Is that the Something About Humanity card game? Which card game are you talking about?
Get some cannabis card game? Some
card?
Oh, it's the poker tournament.
Oh, I've heard about that. That's right. I forgot they used to have that. The
cannabis poker tournament occurs every springtime at mm-hmm. a different location.
Mm-hmm. I didn't know if they were having
it. It was fun. I went to it last year.
I believe there's talks of it again this year.
Yeah, they
the
want
Chronic
to do
Classic
it at my
or something.
Yeah,
the Chronic
Classic.
The Chronic Classic is organized by a gentleman that I know through his mother, and the Chronic Classic has been a very popular event. It's been run for the last, I think, 10 to 15 years here in Las Vegas Underground.
Mm. Yeah, I'll be hosting the next one.
Nice. Okay. We're looking forward to
Before we get out of here, really quickly, guys, I just want to, I must do this and shout out my people, Weed Bros. Weed Bros is the, it's a weed trimmer, weedbros.com, Groovement, Hemp Fest, and my line, Up High Clothing. And I also want to thank Vegas All Net Radio for having me.
Yes.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. And we'd also like to thank our sponsors, Las Vegas Relief, Nevada Pure,
Inyo
Fine Cannabis. Once again, Vegas All Net Radio. We could not do this without all of you guys, and of course, our listeners.
Yes.
It means the world. Mr. Orion, Ms. Nicole.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for blessing us with your time this afternoon, and we hope to have you back. We're looking very much forward to working with you guys in the future to lead this movement forward. So that's it, and we'll see you guys next week.
Let's make it happen. Store.